Well, I appreciate that, Rob. You know, you could have kept preaching. I like listening to you more than I think I like listening to me. So I do appreciate the opportunity to come to speak to you guys tonight. You know, it's an interesting day we live in. And I believe what Rob said is true. The Lord is raising up forerunners. And I personally want to be a part of that company of believers that walk in authority, that walk in dominion, that walk as overcomers. But we're not going to get there haphazardly. We're not going to get there by casual Christianity. We're going to get there by dedicated, wholehearted devotion to the Lord. So that's my heart. I hope you hear that tonight in what I preach about. At this point, I'm not sure exactly what I'm going to preach about, but we'll see as it goes along. You know, I figured out the Lord's not letting me use much of my notes these days. Of course, when I say these days, I've only been preaching for about 3 months, but I figured that out really quick. I'm serious. I'll write out 2 pages of notes, and the Lord won't let me use them. I think the Lord's really bringing us into a time and a season where, you know, like he said to his disciples, I'll give you in that very hour what he wants you to say. It's more of a place of, I'm not against preparation. I think it's more of a preparation by intimacy with the Lord in the secret place, abiding under the secret place of the Most High, to be men and women of prayer, not just, you know, casual prayer, but prayer to gain and seek the burden of the Lord in the heart of God. That's the only thing that's going to change us. It'll change us and it'll change those around us. So let's go back to the Lord in prayer before we get started here. Lord Jesus, we come before you tonight. Lord, we ask that you would have your way in this place, that you would open up each and every one of our hearts to receive you in an ever-increasing measure, O God. Lord, we've seen great and powerful things, but Lord, we say it has not been enough. We are not satisfied, O God. Lord, we want more of you. We want the fullness, Lord, that's been prophesied about, that we've seen both biblically and historically, O God. We ask for your release in this place. We ask for your release in this people, O God. Show us the steps that we need to take to be carriers of your glory, to be carriers of your burden, Lord, to change, Father, the situation, both in the world and in the church, in this nation. Jesus, raise up those here, even now, who will go be above and beyond the normal, Lord, who will seek your face, who will worship you in spirit and in truth, O God, who will give you what you desire in this hour. Lord, we love you. We ask for you. You are the only thing that truly satisfies us, O God. Make that more real to our hearts than we've ever seen before. I ask that you would put a holy desperation in us, God, a desperation that pulls you out of the heavens and pulls you down onto the earth, Lord, that your glory may be released and that your name would be high and lifted up. In the name of Jesus, amen. Turn with me to Malachi 3, starting in verse 1. I've got a few things I feel like the Lord wants me to talk about, so we'll see. I'm not, when I was before him, I just wasn't sure exactly which direction he wanted me to go, so bear with me if it gets rough. Malachi 3, verse 1. Behold, I am going to send my messenger, and he will clear the way before me. Now, we all know that this was prophetically spoken when John the Baptist came. But I believe before the Lord comes again, he is going to send out his messengers to clear the way, prepare the way. It's going to be a different breed. It's going to look different than what we currently see. It's not going to be, let's say this, it's not going to be a generational company. It's going to be mixed between old and young. The coming move of God is not for one generation. It's for all the people that are on the earth. And I'll say this as a young person, if the older generation, if the young people do not embrace the older generation and the older generation do not raise up the young people, it will not happen. I'll say this as a young person, I need those who have walked in front of me, who have been matured in the Lord, to help me get to where God wants me to go. I have a great problem. I'm just going to say this. I have a great problem with what I hear being prophesied over my generation right now, because that is being completely left out. And it breeds an entitlement mentality where we think we're going to get it all without not only honoring, but gleaning off of those who have gone before. And we will not get there without that. Amen? So that's a challenge. That's a challenge to me. That's a challenge to the older generation. Not to give up. Not to pass on what the Lord has given you. The Lord has not sidestepped or gone beyond this generation. The promises are still there for you. They're not coming to us. They're coming to all of us. That's part of the Malachi, where it says here in Malachi, the turning the fathers to the children and the children to the fathers. It's going to be both of us coming together, joining hands, and going up the mountain of God. Amen? Okay. So the Lord's going to send his messengers. And it says here in Malachi 4, verse 5, Behold, I'm going to send you Elijah, the prophet, before the coming of the great and terrible day of the Lord. Let's move over to Luke 13. Start in Luke 1:13. Sorry, 1:13. And I just want to make a note of this here. This is talking about the birth of John the Baptist, Zacharias and Elizabeth. Verse 6, it says, They were both righteous in the sight of God, walking blamelessly in all the commandments and requirements of the Lord. How many of you know that to birth what God wants to birth in this hour, we're going to have to be walking righteously and blamelessly before the Lord? That is a requirement. That is a commandment. I know we're not big on requirements and commandments these days in the church, but there are absolutely standards, requirements, and commandments of God. Amen? And this is one of them. To be a part of what the Lord is going to do, you're going to have to walk righteously by the grace of God, by the Spirit of Christ in you being fully expressed, but you are going to have to make a choice to come into alignment with the Lord and be a part of what he wants to do. You're going to have to lay down your own agenda. You're going to have to lay down your own ambitions. You're going to have to lay down the legitimate concerns, pleasures, and rights of this life to be a part of this company. Few will do it, but it's an open invitation to whoever will come, I believe. There's different measures of that, there's greater corporate expressions of that, but the preachers of righteousness that the Lord is raising up in this hour will not just be those in the pulpit, it'll be those in their own spheres of influence, in the job, in the workplace. They will affect those around them. They will preach the truth, and they will see those respond. You know, the Lord is going to call out into the highways and the byways. Part of that is through us. Amen? Okay, let's get to this in verse 13. But the angel said to him, Do not be afraid, Zacharias, for your petition has been heard. And your wife, Elizabeth, will bear you a son, and you will give him the name John. So already we can see it says for your petition, so prayer. It's one of the first things we can notice about this. They had been in prayer for the will of the Lord. Much of what Dad has been talking about with Hannah, bearing Samuel, bringing forth the purpose of God, reinstituting the righteousness of God back in a nation. This is exactly what John the Baptist did. Verse 14, you will have joy and gladness, and many will rejoice at his birth, for he will be great in the sight of the Lord. Don't you want to be great in the sight of the Lord? That tells me that there are some who are not great in the sight of the Lord. I want to be one who is great in the sight of the Lord. The Lord does not show partiality to the flesh, but he does show partiality to dedication. He does show partiality to those who are fully giving over to him. Amen? It's a matter of love. It's a matter of wholeheartedness. He will honor those who fully honor them in his life, in their lives. Verse 15, for he will be great in the sight of the Lord, and he will drink no wine or liquor. So he was a Nazarite, and we'll go more into that. That's more where I'm getting to, but I just wanted to hit this a little bit. And he will be filled with the Holy Spirit while yet in his mother's womb, and he will turn many of the sons of Israel back to the Lord their God. It is he who will go as a forerunner before him in the spirit and power of Elijah to turn the hearts of the fathers back to the children and the disobedient to the attitude of the righteous. Isn't that what we need today? The disobedient to be turned back to the attitude of the righteous. In the church even. Hear my emphasis on that. This isn't just talking about outside in the world. Yes, absolutely, 100% true. We know that. Sinners sin. That's why they're not part of the body of Christ. Now we have people in the church who are walking as those in the world. They're married to the world. The church, forgive me for saying this, but the church in general in America is married, walking hand in hand with the world. Otherwise, our nation would not be in the condition it is in. It would be impossible for the church to be what it's supposed to be and our nation to be in the predicament it's in. Amen? Verse 17, to turn the hearts of the fathers back to the children and the disobedient to the attitude of the righteous so as to make ready a people prepared for the Lord. That's what we read in Malachi 3. Send his messenger ahead to make ready a people prepared for the Lord. Now, let's go ahead and move over to number 6. This is really what I wanted to kind of set this up, talk about this. Now, this weekend, we've been talking a lot about the priesthood, the Levitical priesthood. And how many of you know that the Levitical priesthood was rewarded for their place because of their obedience to the Lord? Exodus 32 and 33, Moses called for all who were on the Lord's side to come to him, and the Levites came to him. And they were obedient, even to the killing and the slaying of their brothers, their friends, and their neighbors. Ultimate act of obedience. I know it's hard for us to think about that today, but it's really true. But there was also another covenant that was made. There's those specifically called out by the Lord to be ministers to him, and those were the Levites. But there was also the Nazarites. And if anybody wonders why my beard's all messy and my hair is long, it's because the Lord asked me to fulfill a Nazarite vow. So, and it is New Testament. Paul actually did it in Acts 18:18, so it's not some kind of Old Testament law that's being heaped on my head for anybody's worried about that. Let's go number 6, starting in verse 1. Again, the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, speak to the sons of Israel and say to them, when a man or woman, catch that, ladies, man or women, no difference, when a man or woman makes a special vow, the vow of a Nazarite. Now, the word Nazarite actually means separated to the Lord or consecrated to the Lord. the vow of a Nazarite to dedicate himself to the Lord, there it is, he shall abstain from wine and strong drink, which is what we read about John the Baptist. He shall drink no vinegar, whether made from wine or strong drink, nor shall he drink any grape juice, nor eat a fresh or dried grape. So nothing of the grape was allowed. All the days of his separation, he shall not eat anything that is produced by the grapevine, from the seeds to their skin. All the days of his vow of separation, no razor shall pass over his head. He shall be holy until the days are fulfilled for which he separated himself to the Lord. He shall let the locks of his hair on his head grow long. All the days of his separation to the Lord, he shall not go near a dead person. He shall not make himself unclean for his father or for his mother, for his brother or for his sister when they die, because his separation to God is on his head. All the days of his separation, he is holy to the Lord. I just want to go through some of this, what this means. You know, there's a lot of different stuff in this. Why did the Lord have him do this? Let's start with verse 4, where it says, all the days of his separation he should not eat anything that is produced by the grapevine. The first thing that was affected was the Nazarite's diet, what they ingested, what they fed on. The reason they couldn't have grape, because in Israel, grapes were one of their greatest delicacies. They were one of the greatest pleasures that they were allowed to indulge in. So right off the bat, they were separating themselves unto the Lord from the legitimate pleasures that they had, the legitimate rights that they had as a nation, for the sake of God. That's important, because that's going to be important for us in the days of the head and even now, to be a part of what the Lord wants to do. I can't overemphasize that enough. There are things that are legitimate that we have to do, and then there's, Dad talked about this, things that aren't legitimate that we think are legitimate, things we give ourselves to. That's going to all have to change if we want to be used of the Lord. Now is the decision time for us. There is a small window of opportunity here to be a participant in what the Lord wants to do. The door is closing quickly. The Lord has made that clear to me. I do not want to be sitting on the sidelines with what the Lord's about to do and is doing currently. That's why I'm up here. I'm up here because I see a generation going to hell on the fast track, and I cannot sit by and be quiet and watch that happen. Amen? Amen. I don't know where that came from. Sorry. A little bit of Dad's anointing's on me tonight, I guess. Okay, the second part of this. No razor shall pass over their head. You know, there's the obvious that is their appearance. But I think that something else as well. Dad alluded to this earlier in the message, in one of his messages, about sending the Nazarites out in battle. And that's what they would do. Not only, as he was saying, to see if they could be killed, but also to inspire the people. To go out before them and inspire them in the day of battle. We need people to walk in a way to inspire others in this day of battle. Amen? To be prototypes of what the Lord wants. To give up legitimate lives that could be lived in pleasure, in ease, all the different things we could give ourselves to. We need people to make the sacrifice and walk as a different breed of people. I believe that's the call to the whole church. I believe if the church is not cannot walk as a different breed of people, we don't have a right to be here. We're called out of the world. That doesn't mean you don't have to go to work. That does mean that you're going to look different at work than everybody else. That does mean in everything you do, you are going to look different. Do everything as unto the Lord. Let the Lord do everything he wants through you. Fully, fully. That's what we're pressing for here, is fullness. If you can hear it in what Dad's been saying all weekend, it's fullness. It's not that we haven't had a taste of the Lord. It's not that we haven't had a glimpse, but we are not there. If this is all there is, then the New Testament, the Old Testament, is a lie. We have not seen what we're supposed to see. And it's not because of God. It's because of us. The Lord is not holding himself back just to play games. It's because we've decided to play games. We will get the measure of the Lord that we want, both individually and corporately. That has always been true. So they weren't supposed to cut their hair. They're supposed to be a different, look differently than those around them. They took no account for their own appearance, no account for their own lives. Verse 6, you shall not go near a dead person. Now, a lot of people, you know, talks about even with their brother or their sister. But the Lord said, I didn't come to bring peace, but a sword. Father against son, son-in-law against father, daughter against mother. There's a time of separation from all things that contain death, all things that can affect our hearts, even to a point, and forgive me for saying this, even to a point of relationships that have been not of God and have influenced us in our place of dedication, in our place of zealousness. The zealousy of the Lord is needed in this hour. Not zealousy without wisdom and understanding. Zealousy for God, not the things of God, not any of that. I'm afraid in the church that when I've seen this, people have gotten saved, they're zealous for God, they get on fire, then they get hurt, they don't see what they thought they would see, and then they become lukewarm. And then those coming in behind have a zealousy for the Lord. And there's this way of people trying to temper expectations. We need an increase of our expectation of the Lord in this hour. I'm not afraid of being overzealous in this hour. Amen? If there's ever an hour to be, if I'm going to err, I'm going to err on that side. That's the only way to be. I know we've heard a lot of teaching on different things, and now is the time to kindle the flame anew. Don't care about what other people think. If you lived up to other people's expectations, you probably wouldn't even be a Christian. We have to get rid of the fear of men, the man-pleasing spirit. And I've dealt with this, so I'll honestly say it. It will control your life, and it will completely take away your heart for God, your zealousness for God, the fire of the Lord. You know, the fire of God, the Lord showed me this in a vision. The fire of God, the Lord kindles it. But just like a candle in your house, if you have your windows open, you're responsible for closing the windows, that it not be snuffed out by the wind. We can do that. We can close off areas in our life that would destroy the flame of the Lord inside of us. And we're going to have to do it, brothers and sisters. And it's going to take a conscious effort in every aspect of our lives. When we're at home, when we're at work, friendships. That's the tough one. You know, if you're in a friendship with somebody and you're going after the Lord, amen. If you're ministering to somebody, they don't know the Lord, amen. If you're walking with somebody who's not after God and they're pulling you down and they're in your sphere of influence and they're not pressing you onto the Lord, I'm telling you, it's going to come to a head. You're either going to come down to their level or you're going to have to walk away. Because in this hour, when we need to be running after the Lord, we want to take people with us, but we can't wait for people. I know that's hard to hear. It's difficult. It goes against much of what we've been taught. But if we wait for people, we'll wait forever. Speak the truth, love them, share what you can, but go after the Lord most importantly. Do not stop. Do not settle. Amen? So our associations of spiritual death cannot be entertained or allow anybody in a place of sphere of our influence to produce spiritual death. We can't allow that in our lives. Amen. So the Lord is raising up these preachers of righteousness, as in 2 Peter 2:5. Peter calls Noah a preacher of righteousness. And they're going to go before in the spirit and power of Elijah. And they're going to make a way to set up a highway of holiness for our God, that no unclean thing would walk upon it. Only those who walk in the way of righteousness will be able to walk on it. And that's what the Lord's calling for in this hour. He's calling for the standard of God to be reinstituted in his people. Reinstituted in his church. Amen? It's a call that few can hear, I'm afraid. Because we have doctrines saying every other different thing, that there's no need for it. But I'm telling you, the Lord's standard of holiness has never changed. From the Old Testament to the New Testament, it's the ultimate standard for his people. I don't care what anyone else tells you. Don't believe it. You know, part of the enemy's work is to introduce these doctrines of demons. We've all been talking to him. Dispensationalism is one of them, completely discrediting your Old Testament. You know, Dad said this before, 45%, right, of the Old Testament is quoted in the New Testament, with 15 to 20% of direct allusion. Peter says, "Be ye holy as he is holy." We need the Spirit of the Lord to come again and to show us where we've erred, to call us back to repentance. You know, why is that so hard for us? To get with the Lord and say, "God, I want you. I don't want my own way. I don't want my own will. I don't desire my own life." You know, the Lord's calling for a life laid down, given over completely to him. That's what he's always been asking for. A people that are peculiar possession. That's what he's always asked. From Israel all the way through. His call has not changed. We might think it has, but it hasn't. The Lord wishes to apply the blood that Dad was talking about to the Levitical priesthood. He wishes to apply it to us. Not just the sprinkled blood of salvation, the applied blood of the priesthood. There's a difference. We've got to see the difference. Most of us aren't currently in a place where we can be useful to the Lord. But he wants to get us there. It demands complete obedience. It demands a life that doesn't look to their own good, doesn't look to themselves. I pray for this every day in my own life. Lord, your will be done. Into your hands I commit my spirit. The prayer of submission. We need that again in this hour. A day where the church is trying to have their own life and walk in their own life and have salvation and have their ticket to heaven, their fire insurance policy. The Lord is asking those who will be set ablaze for him and be torches for him in the world. In the church, in the highways and in the byways, and call all men unto the Lord. Let your light shine in a way that they see it and glorify your Father in heaven. Glorify God. That's God's call. Each and every one of us are meant to be participants of the divine, holy, spiritual call of God in this hour, to be a useful vessel. You know, we all have to stand before the judgment seat of Christ one day. It says in 1 Corinthians 3, some people will suffer loss. I've never seen anybody excited about suffering loss. I think about that every day of my life, my personal accountability to God that day. With as much light as I've been given in my life that I'm responsible for, to whom much is given, much is required. This message you hear, the messages you've heard this weekend, there's a requirement now on you. It's not on anybody else, it's upon you. We'll be responsible for this at the judgment seat of Christ. Well, the Lord says, I was calling to you. I was asking for you. Come to me. Come to me in this hour. Align yourself with me in my purpose, my plan. What are we going to say? I had other things to do. I had better things to do. There is no other reason for us to exist except for to be obedient and serve the Lord Jesus Christ and bring honor and glory to his name. That's it. You know, we're supposed to be disciples of Christ, disciplined in Christ. That's what that means, disciplined in the Lord. And it's going to demand a discipline, a determination to know nothing in our lives but Christ and him crucified. To be dead to sin and alive to God. So the Lord is calling for these Nazarites. And it's not just, obviously, a thing of the outward. It's a spiritual sign. It's a spiritual token of the inward, of the heart of a Nazarite. Those who will lay down everything for the Lord to be completely consecrated, set apart, for every good work, to the will and glory of God the Father. It goes beyond, like I said before, it goes beyond generation. It's never too late to walk in the perfect will of the Lord. I want to say that. Here tonight, you could make a conscious decision to walk in the perfect will of God that he's had for your whole life. Some things are missed, yes. But he still is calling and asking, come to me. There's still time to be the vessel that I've called you to be in this hour. Why you are here, why you were born to begin with. You know, I see that as one of the biggest signs of the grace of God to even be born. To have a choice to be a part of the eternal kingdom of God is the most gracious thing I've ever known. Not even the fact that he gave me wonderful parents and friends who love the Lord, but even the chance to choose the Lord. Even in this fallen world, I think is one of the greatest aspects of God's grace that I've ever known. From eternity to eternity, everlasting to everlasting, we will be with the Lord. But here and now, the Lord has plans and purposes for us. Amen? We've got to walk fully in it, and it demands a life of obedience. Demands a life of humility, a life not looking to ourselves, not looking to others, looking straight ahead to the Lord, looking straight into the eyes of the Lord, to run the race set before us with perseverance and endurance and steadfastness. I think a lot of us here are in need of that, perseverance. Steadfastness. Lord, I ask that you would release that even now. Lord, reawaken and realive in the heart. Revitalize the spirit, Lord. I ask. Jesus, we ask that the Holy Spirit would come and inspire our hearts afresh. To walk, Lord, as you would have us walk. To look as you would have us look in this hour. To walk as a different breed of people. Lord, a people that are called by your name and are ready for every good work, Lord, who are hungry. Jesus, hungry for you. Lord, awaken. Awaken the spirit of the Nazarite in this place, I pray. Awaken the spirit of those who wish to be set apart, who wish to walk set apart lives, Lord. Who will seek your face. Lord, release a desperate cry, I pray, in every heart. Lord, that the full release of the glory of God that you've promised in this place would be seen, that would affect this city, Lord. It would affect this state. It would affect the nation, O God. That everything you had promised, Lord, would come to fruition, that nothing would be missed, O God. Lord, we rebuke the spirit of apathy and lethargy that would try to come in and settle after this conference is over, O God. Kindle, Lord, kindle. And keep the flame going, O God. Lord Jesus, we are in desperate need of you. We cannot do it by ourselves, Lord, but we rend our hearts to you and say, Lord, whatever we can do, we will do. Show us your way, Lord. Show us your path. Reinstitute passion for the Son of God, I pray. Oh, Jesus, let the glory be seen here. Let the glory be known here. Establish your glory in and among a people, Lord. A faithful people, a desperate people, a holy people. Jesus, you have called. Let them answer fully, I pray. Lord, you will not leave them as orphans. God, you have called them as children and as sons of God to walk righteously, wholeheartedly in this hour. Lord, let nothing be missed, I pray. Lord, we stand in the gap for this community. Lord, bring many sons to the kingdom through this church and through this people in their obedience, Lord, and their dedication. Lord, call to the lost. Establish for yourself, Lord. A place where those who are broken and hungry can come and meet you. In Acts 1:14, it says that these all, talking about the disciples when the Holy Spirit was promised on Pentecost, these all with one mind were continually devoting themselves to prayer. They knew the Holy Spirit was coming. They'd been promised it. But they gathered together and they continually devoted themselves to prayer. That's the call. That's God's requirement. To pray the glory down. To open the door, the gate that's been set, fully. Jesus, cleanse this people, I ask. Who may ascend to the hill of the Lord, he who has clean hands and a pure heart. Who may abide in your tent, who may dwell in your holy hill, who walks with integrity and works righteousness and speaks with truth in his heart. Reveal your truth, O God. Let your truth reign in this place. The truth that is Christ be abundantly manifested through this people. Jesus, make us a people of obedience once again. Everyone who feels that, to be just a rededication in obedience, I want you to stand up. You know, my message just got lamb blasted by the Lord, but I don't care. It's been that way the whole night. I knew something weird was going to happen. Lord Jesus, I ask that you would release your spirit, your authority, your power, that you would baptize this people in your obedience, God, that you would speak clearly to them with precision, Lord, like they've never heard. They would walk in your will. They would see, Lord. Lord, you told the disciples you are no longer slaves, you are friends. Why were they friends? Because you said they knew what the master was doing. That's the definition of those who are friends of God. That's our call. That's our born-again birthright. Lord Jesus, I ask that you would show this people your heart fully. And that by your grace and by your help, you will give them, Lord, the tools, the heart to walk it out fully. Jesus, and that they will not stop. They will not grow weary. They would not grow tired, O God. Jesus, we need your perseverance. We need, Lord, a reinvigorating of our spirits. We ask for it, O God. We plead for it, O God. Jesus, we cannot do this without you. Lord, we ask for your spirit of conviction to be among us again. Lord, your spirit of conviction has been lost in the church. It's been lost in your people, Lord. Let it operate in us, that it will operate through us, O God. Lord, that we would walk in that conviction that would change people. Not even by having to say anything, Lord. They would be encountered by the raw presence of the Lord. Lord, let this place be a beacon light for you. Jesus, release yourself in this place. The fullness. Lord, we prophesy it. We declare it that we will not stop. We will not hold back any longer. Lord, that you are faithful, and we in turn will be faithful as well. Lord, that the priesthood, the Nazarites, would be birthed in this place. And it would spread, oh God. It would spread. And it wouldn't stop, Lord. Lord, what you're calling for is not meant to stop. It's meant to spread. To the whole earth, Lord, declares that you alone are God. You alone are God. We submit fully to you, Lord Jesus. We submit to your lordship. Lord, we relent to you. Lord, we will give you what you require in this hour, joyfully. Holy Spirit, present yourself here. Lord, I ask that you would send young people to this church. The men and women of God. Lord, who have walked in this church, who have been here, who have planted their roots here, who have been waiting, Lord. That you would bring them and that you would raise them up, Lord. That you would turn the hearts of these fathers and these mothers spiritually to the children. And that the children would be turned to the fathers. And that they with one accord, Lord, would seek your face. And run after you, Lord. I just want to exhort you guys again, the older people. I felt this a while back, and this might be the only reason I got up here tonight. The other part doesn't even matter. That the promises of God are still in your lives, that they haven't been missed. And I said this before, I'm just reiterating it. They haven't been missed. They haven't gone to the next generation. They are still here. To be taken, to be grasped, if we will grasp them, if we will go with God and turn our hearts fully to Him. They're there. It's our choices that make the difference. Many of you, the Lord has called to raise up this next generation. To speak into their life foundation. Foundation. That's what my generation is missing. Foundation of the Lord Jesus Christ. He's called you to it. Don't give up. Don't back down. Don't cash in your check. The Lord has so much more. And it's never too late. The Lord's face is going to shine upon you and through you. And He's going to draw those who will come under your wings and under the wing of the Lord, whose hearts will be made perfect toward Him. That's His desire. And Lord, we just respond by saying yes. Yes. Just raise your hands to the Lord and say yes. Yes. We say yes to you, Lord. Yes. We say yes to your call. We say yes to your invitation. Do it, Lord. Yeah. See the hearts of these people, I pray, oh God. Mark them. Set them apart. The Lord is going through and marking some of you. Those who are saying yes. There's a lot you're saying yes to right now, and that's good. Different calls, different commissions. Saying yes to the Lord in the intimate place. And I want to encourage you in that. For those of you who haven't really ever had much of a personal place of prayer with the Lord, now is the time for that to be instituted in your life. It's not easy. It's hard. As a young man, I've learned that. It takes the most determination that I've ever had to stay and tarry with the Lord. But once you catch the fire there, there's nothing like it. Now, I want to just extend that challenge to each one of you to make a concerted effort to get alone with God. You know, the church is only as strong as its members, and its members are only as strong as their personal prayer life before the Lord, their personal devotion before God. For the glory of God to be realized here in this place, it's going to take every individual person seeking the glory of God in their own personal life. This is just an extension. And I believe with what the Lord said here this weekend, not only is that happening, but that it's going to happen. Lord, so one last time, we say, your kingdom come, your will be done on this earth, in this place, in our hearts, as it is in heaven, Lord. And give us this day and every day henceforth our daily bread, the bread that is Christ, the true food, the true drink that He is. Let us eat continually in that place of communion with You, O God. You are what you eat, and you become what you eat. Eat of the Lord. Eat of the Lord in this church. From what Pastor Lynn, Rob, what they give, but eat of the Lord on your own time. Show us the way of being disciplined in Christ. We respect discipline everywhere else, but this place we really lack, and the Lord wants to change that. If we can be disciplined in work, if we can be disciplined in watching the TV and disciplined in getting on the internet, we can be disciplined in getting before the Lord and seeking His face. There's nothing else as important as that. All this other stuff's going to burn away. All this other stuff's going to be dross and chaff. When the glory of the Lord comes anyways, it's going to get burned up. Might as well give it up now on your own free will. Otherwise, it's going to hurt a lot more. Amen? So, Lord, I ask that You would identify. Don't worry, I'm closing with this. Lord, that You would identify these different things in our lives that are keeping us, that have duped us, Lord, into believing that they're legitimate and that we need them and we have to have them. Lord, I ask that You would put Your finger on those even now in all our hearts. And for everyone out there, the first thing that came to your mind, that's probably it. It's probably what the Lord's putting His finger on. These things that are keeping us, Lord, from having time to be with You. Our highest calling, our first call, from being the number one priority, Lord. I ask that You would reprioritize, or completely sever it entirely. And that you would let us realize, Lord, that now that we've been confronted with the truth, we're responsible for it. And that we would joyfully, Lord, be responsible and obedient. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. Wasn't that a convicting word? Do we have anybody here to play on the keyboards just for a moment before we come on up? Amen. Amen. The life of a Nazirite. Amen. We need that consecration. We need that dedication. If everyone just stand up again, I know you've been sitting a while. That was a very convicting message from the Lord, and I just have a sense that there's a group of people here, the next generation that wants to make that covenant with the Lord, wants to make that consecration. So if you're under the age of 30 years old, I want you to come on up. If you want to make a commitment, you've heard that this message has convicted you. The life of a Nazirite is something that you desire, something that you have a hunger for. I want you to come on up here. Just if you could just line up now. Hallelujah. Amen. This is the next generation. Hallelujah. You know the burden of my heart, the burden of my heart in this hour is there should be more. Amen. I heard a statistic a little while ago that said that 89% of all those 18 years of old and older who have been raised up in the church, they leave the church at 18 never to return in America. That grieves and burdens my heart. But I believe that there is a generation that God's raising up in this hour. I believe there's a Jacob generation of people that are consecrating, dedicate their lives unto Him. People like Josiah that have made a Nazirite vow to follow the Lord with all their heart. Amen. And Josiah, I'm just going to impose upon you, if you'll just come up here and lay hands on them. And I'm going to ask our ministers, Terry and Pastor Leonard Kay, if you'll come behind them as Josiah lays hands on them and releases the fire of God. Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray, Lord God, you release your fire, oh God. Release your fire to this next generation. I pray, Lord, the spirit of judgment and of burning be released unto them. A holy generation, a holy priesthood, consecrated, dedicated unto your purposes, oh God. Raise up Samuels, raise up Deborahs, raise up Hannahs, oh God. Raise up Davids, oh God. Raise up Timothys, oh God, with the fire of your Holy Spirit. Raise them up in the name of Jesus. A holy generation. I pray, Lord God, that dreams and visions come to these young ones. I pray, Lord God, that you release the spirit of wisdom and revelation to this next generation in the name of Jesus. Lord, that the eyes of their understanding would be enlightened, that they would know what is the hope of your calling, and what is the riches of your glory in the inheritance of the saints, and what is the exceeding greatness of your power towards them who believe, according to the working of your mighty power, which you wrought in Christ when you raised them from the dead. I pray, O God, for a release of the spirit of might upon these young ones in the name of Jesus. I pray, Lord, there would be a fire shut up in their bones in the name of Jesus, and a release of your spirit. And I pray, O God, that out of their belly shall flow rivers of living water. Rivers of living water in the name of Jesus. Horakashia kalabahai. Horababashia kalabahai. Rekeshia kalabahai. In the name of Jesus. Holy Spirit, I pray, Lord God, that you would descend as a dove upon these young ones in the name of Jesus. And I pray that the fire of God would raise up within their spirit man in Jesus' name. Fire of God, fire of God, fire of God. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, rise up, rise up, rise up, Joshua, rise up, Joshua, rise up, Joshua, rise up, Hannah, rise up, Hannah, rise up, Deborah, rise up, oh Rachel, rise up, give birth. Give birth to this next generation. In the name of Jesus. No compromise. No compromise. Out of your belly shall flow rivers of living water. In the name of Jesus. No compromise. No compromise. No compromise. No retreat. Father, in Jesus' name, we commit to pray for this next generation, O God. Father, we covenant with you, O God, to mentor, to bless, to teach this next generation. And Father, we repent for where we have fallen short. We repent before you. We repent before this next generation. We repent, oh God, for letting them down. Father, I pray, Lord, that you raise up mentors in the midst of the congregation. Raise up mentors, oh God, that would pray for, lay hands on, teach, commend, bless this next generation. Raise up, rise up, O Deborah. Rise up, O Deborah, in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Hurrabakashia kalabaroboboshia kalabaha. Hurrabakoshia kalabaha. Father, I pray, Lord, for an increase in anointing. I pray, Lord God, for the anointing of the prophetic gift to begin to arise upon this daughter of Zion. I pray for the psalmist and the anointing of the psalmist of the Lord. I pray, Lord God, she begin to prophesy upon the scripture, upon the instruments. And the Lord said that the anointing will begin to break bondages as you pray. As you play, and the song of the Lord shall come forth with might and power. In the name of Jesus, receive it, receive it, receive it. Father, And the Lord says, I placed a spirit and mantle of Deborah upon you. And the Lord says, I shall cause my sword to be raised in your behalf. And the Lord says, I will cause you to right those things that have been wrong and be a champion of the weak in these last days. The Lord says, though you've been silent, the Lord says, I'm going to fill your mouth with my words, and I will cause you to raise your mouth as a trumpet, and as a mantle of deliverance shall be upon you to extricate your generation from the wiles of Satan in the world that has bound them. For the Lord says, my anointing is upon you to break chains and to raise the banner of holiness and righteousness, for I will give you a voice, my daughter. And the Lord says, as you sing, you will break chains of bondage. Arise, for I'll open a door that no man can shut. And my glory shall rise upon you, for that which is hidden shall be brought into the light. That which is hidden shall be brought into the light. For the fire shall rise up within your belly. And the Lord says, the intercessions of my spirit shall cause you to weep for your generation. And the Lord says, I will open a door and cause you to speak and deliver a generation for me, says the Lord. Hallelujah. Horakashia karabaha. We give you praise, O God. We give you glory. We give you honor, O God. Give him praise, church. Give him praise. Give him praise. You're worthy, O God. You're worthy, O God, to receive blessing and glory and honor, O God. In the name of Jesus, we thank you for your fire, O God. Work in the midst of your people. Stir up this generation, O God. Hallelujah. And I speak to the generation that is out here. And the Lord wants you to know that he's recovering the lost calling. And the Lord says, I have an alternate path for you to fulfill your ultimate destination. The Lord says, I've not forgotten you. And I've not forgotten the plans and the purposes that I've called upon you before time began. For I will rescue you. And the Lord says, I will remove the cloak of shame that is over your life. And I will cause you not to draw back in fear any longer, but you will rise and shine, and my glory shall rise upon you. Take upon the mantle that I've given unto you. Do not forfeit nor cast it away, for it shall be yours if you will claim it. And the Lord says, go forth in faith, for the spirit of Caleb and the spirit of Joshua is upon you, and you shall not be denied the blessing. You shall not be denied your mountain. The Lord says, take your mountain, for it is yours. Draw back no longer in fear, for the Lord says, I have ordained you to fulfill the purposes of God for this generation. I have not passed you by. Lay hold upon it and lay hold upon the horns of the altar. For the Lord says, it is yours for the taking, says the Lord. Amen. Hallelujah. We give you praise, O God. We give you glory. We give you honor, O God. In the name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The Lord's doing a new thing. As Terry said, these are unprecedented times. There's a door of opportunity, even as Josiah said, there's a door of opportunity for us. We must go through it. We must go through it. These are desperate times. It's windows of opportunity. God's looking for a bride. Amen. Hallelujah. And I believe what Josiah said tonight, that he's marrying the generations. He has to. He has to. If we're going to see this thing through. We're just going to continue on in the Lord here. If you feel like you need to leave, you can. I don't know if we're going to actually close the service. We're just going to allow those to wait upon the Lord if they would like to, and you're free to go if you would like to. But Father, in Jesus' name, we just consecrate and dedicate, Lord, everything that has happened in this service, this weekend, oh God. Lord, the precious words, Lord, that's come forth from your servants, Terry and Josiah, oh God. Father, we treasure them in our hearts. I pray, Lord God, that you would seal the words of the Lord, that, Lord, that you've burned within our spirits. Lord, that we would never be the same again. Help us to consecrate and dedicate ourselves unto you. Lord, to be that holy priesthood. That holy priesthood, oh God. Consecrated and dedicated unto your purposes. Father, we desire you more than gold. We desire you more than silver. We desire you more than life itself. We're desperate for you, oh God. As the deer panteth for the water brook, so our souls long after you, O God. Help us to seek first your kingdom and your righteousness, O God. O God, you are our God. Early we will seek you. For Lord, we are in a dry and thirsty land, but we pant after you, O God. And we might seek your power and your glory. Lord, we see the King of Glory come in all of your power and all of your glory. And Father, we thank you, Lord, for the gates, Lord, that you've erected even in this place, oh God. The gate of God. And we say, oh King of Glory, come down. We welcome you, O King of Glory. King of Glory, come into this place. Let it be, as it were, the habitation of the Lord in the Spirit. And Father, we covenant to make this place a holy ground, a holy place. Lord, let no defilement come into the sanctuary of God. And Lord, help us to protect the glory. Let it be, as it were, a holy place, a place of fire, a place of the wind of your Spirit, a place of healing, a place of deliverance, a place of glory. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Have your way, O God.